Last week I completely forgot to send you the link, so today I will not forget to send the link, so don't worry, the link with the video will be sent today, okay? So, we have studied, what we have studied up to today? We have studied
linear
simple,
equation.
First simple hypothesis testing. This testing. We have studied linear regression. Linear regression. And we have studied logit regression. Simple hypothesis testing, I mean about the mean. So, we have studied these algorithms. These algorithms are used to explain data, to simplify complex data set into a single equation. These algorithms are used to give a simple description of a data set. So, when we estimate the mean, we simply say the mean is equal to, and the confidence interval is the following. When we estimate a linear regression, we obtain a simple compact equation. And with logit regression, it's a little bit more difficult, but nevertheless, we have marginal effects, and we have some numbers that describe our data set. There is a goal. Sometimes we do not, So sometimes we do not want a simple description, but there is another goal. There is a goal to make predictions. Make predictions. Surely we can make prediction using linear regression or using logit regression or using simple mean. We can say the next observation will be equal to the sample mean of the previous observations. But these two goals, to give a simple description of a data set and to make good predictions, this is not the same goal. So sometimes we can sacrifice simple description in favor of a good prediction. We may build a very complex model, which is very hard to interpret, but that model makes very good predictions. Or vice versa, we can say, no, oh, my model will make predictions that are far from perfect, but it's simple and it describes my data set in simple words. So these two goals, it's not the same goal, okay? Yeah. We have two goals, give a simple description and make good predictions. These two goals are similar, but this is not the same goal. So today we will speak about an algorithm which is used here. So linear regression, logit regression, simple hypothesis testing. Yes, we may use them to make predictions, but the main purpose is to give a simple description of a data set. And today we will study another algorithm, random forest. Random forest. So, let's... I don't know whether you have heard about random forest. No?
No.
But I'm sure that many aspects of your life are controlled by somewhere by random forest.
Random forest.
Yeah. Yeah. I will show you, for example, one. One use of a random forest. There are a lot of use for random forest when a bank classifies when bank decides to whether to give credit or not to give credit to a person. Maybe the best idea is to use random forest. There are many applications of random forest. One application which I found recently. I will zoom. Yeah, for example, this guy, former director of, you know what does it mean, yeah. It's
Central Intelligence Agency.
Yeah, you're right, and
National Security
Agency. So, for example, how we built a random forest. We collect a lot of metadata for citizens, for example, cell metadata, coordinates, and we classify each person as terrorist or non-terrorist using random forest, and then we use drones to kill terrorists, yeah? But sometimes we kill innocent people, yeah. But it really goes like this. Yeah, Skynet algorithm uses a random forest. So random forest is very robust. You have no things, no almost nothing to set up. You just run this algorithm and it makes pretty good predictions. So, okay. Let's start. Yeah?
Yeah.
So to build forest, first we need to build one tree. What is a tree? Forest is a lot of trees. Yeah? It's simple. How we will build one tree to classify whether a person is a terrorist or not a terrorist? A lot of trees. Let's say 500 trees. So we have some explanatory variables and one dependent variable. So we have y, dependent variable. And we have some predictors. I will denote them by X and Z, but there may be not two, but not 200, but 2,000 predictors. So we have some explanatory variables. Variables.
maybe
we may have more than 1,000 explanatory variables, but I will go with just with two explanatory variables. So what is a tree? I will divide my sample at each step, at each node of a tree, I will divide my sample into two subgroups. So, for example, this is my data set. I may ask a simple question, like, for example, whether x is greater than 100. And there are observations where x is greater than 100, and there are observations where x is lower than 100. Then I may ask another question. I ask only simple questions of type whether some variable is bigger than some threshold. I may ask another question. Whether that is greater than 50. I may say yes or no. And there, on the right, in the right node, I may ask a question whether x is greater than 70. And divide my tree into yes or no. And we will build a tree. Why it's called a tree? Because if you look at it from the root, you will see something like this. Yeah. If this is the root of a tree. We build a tree, and then when we have a tree, we may do forecasts. So we have a tree, x greater than 100, yes, no, z is greater than 50, yes, no. X is greater than 70, yes, no, and for example, x is greater than 200, yes, no, and in these leaves we have predictions. For example, we predict that this person is a terrorist, y is equal to 1, this person is not a terrorist, y is equal to 0, this y we have equal to 1, have predictions, y equal to 0, and y equal to 1. Yeah. It's a typical tree. So we need a procedure to build a tree. We need a procedure how a tree, how to build a tree. And when the tree is ready, we may simply use it for making predictions. For example, if I have x equal to 250 and z equal to 100, what will be my prediction? If I use this simple tree, if I have a person with x equal to 250 and z equal to 100, what's my prediction?
Zero.
A simple question, how we use a tree for predictions? Yeah, we just, I have a person, x is equal, for this person, x, I don't know, the sum in the wallet, x is equal to 250, so I go, which?
Yes.
We,
yes.
Yeah,
yes.
I go to yes. Yes. Then ask the second question, whether z is greater than 50?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, I go here, whether x is greater than 200? Yes? So I classify this person as a bad guy. Yeah?
Okay. Terrorist.
Yeah. So it's easy to use it when the tree is built. It's very easy to use a tree for prediction. Okay? The main problem may be this tree. This is a picture of a very simple tree, but in random forest, a real tree maybe we have one, two, three, say, let's say levels, yeah? One first level of questions, second level of third level of question. And the real tree in the random forest may have, I don't know, 1,000 levels. So it's a very big tree, yeah? There may be many characteristics. I may ask many, many, many questions. But the procedure is done on the computer, so it's very fast. Do you understand how to use a tree for predictions? Yeah? Anna? Okay. Are you ready to say who is this guy, terrorist or not?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So it's very simple. So the main question is how to build a tree. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little bit harder to understand. So let's try to understand the principles how to build a tree. Because how to use a tree for predictions, how to predict using a tree, just choose the right branch. Just choose the correct answer. So let's build a tree. So the main question is how to build a tree. So I have y, which is either 0 or 1. We would like to forecast some binary random or some binary variable. If I have a sample of persons, I have, let's say, n persons, and among these n persons, I have n zero good guys, and n1 bad guys. Y equal to 1. So certainly n0 plus n1 is equal to m. Okay? I will introduce a measure of, it's called a measure of impurity of a sample. It's called a measure of impurity of a sample. It's called Gini index. The probability definition, the measure of impurity of a sample, it's a Gini index. It's a probability that two randomly selected observations will be of different class. So let's do this simple calculation, small exercise. For better understanding, exercise. If I have 1,000 people. I have 20 bad guys and 980 good guys. What's the Gini index for this set? I have 1,000 person, 20 bad guys, and 980 good guys. What's the Gini index for this set? It's the probability that when I select two random persons independently, they will be of the same type or of different class. If I select two persons, yeah, how they may be of different class?
Mostly they will be from one class, the biggest.
Yeah, I understand that. But what's the probability that they will be of different class if I select two persons randomly? What's the Gini index for this sample? I choose the first person randomly, so I have a probability. So let's calculate this probability. Maybe the first person is bad. And then to have a different class, the second person should be from the other class. So I multiplied by 980 divided by 100. This is the first possibility, that the two observations are in different classes. The first is bad, the second is good. Plus, I have another probability. Which one? Yeah, the first person is good, yeah. The second person is bad. And so the Gini index for this set is, if I do arithmetics, I will have 0.02 times 0.0392. So it's a Gini index. We should understand that this is really a measure of impurity. If I take a sample where all observations are of the same class, another small example. If I take a sample whether all observations are, let's say, crosses, I have n is equal to, let's say, 200, and 1 is equal to 200, and 0 is 0. For this data set, when all observations belong to the same class, I will have the Gini index equal to 0, because what's the probability if I choose two persons at random from this set? What's the probability that they will have different class? Yeah. It's 0, yeah, because all of them are from the same class. It's 0. And the hardest case to separate, if I have a data set which is maybe split exactly in two halves. If I have 8 observations, 4 of them are from one class and 4 of them are from the other class, what's the Gini index for this data set? I use the same formula. and I obtain 1 over 2 times 1 over 2 plus 1 over 2 times 1 over 2, I obtain 1 over
2.
1 over 2. Okay? So this is the case where the impurity measure is equal to 0. This Gini index is equal to 0. This is the other extreme possibility. The maximum value of Gini index is equal to 1 over 2. So Gini index always lies between 0 and 1 over 2. These two extreme cases. Okay? So how a tree is built? How a tree is built? When we understand the concept of Gini index, we can build a, we almost can build a tree. If I have a sample which is not split, I can calculate the Gini index before split. Gini, let's say before split. And I may calculate the Gini index after this, after a split. If I split these, no order. If I split these nodes in two nodes using some question like x greater than 50. Yeah. I split this node into two nodes. So I may calculate the Gini index for the left node, Gini, let's say left, Gini index for the right node, and the Gini index after the split, Gini after split, will be equal to the size of the left node, n left divided by n times Gini index of the left. No, I will zoom my formula. Gini index after split is equal to n left, the size of the left node, the number of observations in the left node divided by the total size, times Gini in the left node plus the size of the right node divided by n times Gini in the right node. So now when I have defined the Gini index before split, the Gini index after the split, the algorithm of growing a tree is very simple. We just choose a split in such a way to, we are interested. Just a simple question. We're interested in minimizing or maximizing Gini index. When we want to make good predictions, we would like to have Gini index equal to 0 or Gini index equal to 1 over 2, where it's easy to predict. Very easy
but
to predict the
question. It's possible to have 2 if it's only a possibility highest as 1. You said Gini like could be 1 or 2.
No. Gini index is between. Gini index is always
one.
Between 0 and 0.5. Okay. Yeah, it can't be 1.
Okay.
So for which group it's easy to predict the class? For this one, or for this one? Yeah, because. Here I may easily predict everyone is, if you take a random person from this group and you ask me who is this person? I may say a bad guy, yeah? Mm-hmm. And if I take randomly a person from this group, it's a bad guy with probability 1 over 2 and a good guy with probability 1 over 2, okay? So we are interested in minimizing the Gini index, yeah? So the algorithm, how the answer to the question, how you grow a tree, is to minimize, choose a question, the splitting question, choose a splitting question to minimize Gini index at each split. How to grow a tree? Choose a splitting question to minimize Gini index at each split. Okay? So let's build our tree by hands, and then we will use a computer. Exercise. You have a very simple data set. Y, X, I will only have, let's say, 5 observations. X is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And Y is equal to 0, 1, 1, 0, 0. Or maybe 1. And the aim of this exercise to grow a classification tree using Gini index. So our goal is to, using the variable x to predict the y, but we may ask only simple questions, whether x is greater than something, okay? So we always ask very simple questions. You in random forest, we have right only to ask, is x is greater than 2? Or x, whether x is greater than 4, or whether x is greater than 1. And we need to build a tree which will predict perfectly the type of each person, okay? Yeah? So, how we should start?
We have to draw three.
Yeah, we need to draw a tree, but what will be the first question? Why is greater than 1? Why not 2? Why not 2? Why not 3?
2 and a half.
Why is 3 and a half? Why?
5 is the maximum.
So, no, we need to proceed with this rule. Choose the splitting question to minimize Gini index at each split. So, this is a rule to building a tree in a random forest. So, I will just calculate the Gini index, the actual Gini index before split. So, step one, I calculate Gini index before split. Before split, I have 5 observations, 3 of them are 1s, and 2 of them are 0s, okay? So what's the value of Gini index before split? how do we calculate the Gini index?
Equal to zero.
It's
equal to zero.
Why? What's the...
We calculated by the Gini index, by the formula of Gini index.
Yeah, but let's calculate by... Yeah, 2 over 5, yeah, exactly, Patrick. 2 over 5 times 3 over 5 plus 3 over 5 times 2 over 5, yeah, exactly. We may give in the case of only two values, because random forest is a very powerful algorithm, it may be used to... We may define Gini index not only when we have two predicted classes, but we may classify as good guys, bad guys, and not so good guys. Yeah? So we may have more than two classes. But in this simple case, the formula for Gini index is very simple. We just multiply the probability of the proportion of a bad guy times the proportion of a good guy plus proportion of good guy times proportion of bad guy, and we see that it's 2p0 times p crosses. So in our case, it's 2 times 3 over 5 times 2 over 5. Yeah, you may ask.
Why don't we calculate 2 times probability?
Why we calculate 2 times? Because this rule is universal. When you try to define something which will measure the impurity in the case when there are many classes, for example, let's say 5 classes, you classify to make targeted advertising, you classify persons as say young girls, women at some specific age group, men, elder men, young boys. So you have, let's say, 10 or 20 groups, and using the data on the sleep. На чеке. On the bill, yeah, on the bill, your program should automatically classify a person into one of these many groups, and this definition is okay. It's a probability of choosing two observations with different classes. So in case of just two classes, yeah, we may dismiss these two, but the definition of Gini index may be applied to a case when there are more than two groups. So, and the formula will not have two here. Yeah. If I have three classes, for example, I have crosses, circles, and triangles, yeah, I will have the probability of x times the sum. Yeah, mm-hmm. Different class plus p circle times p crosses plus p triangle plus p triangle times p circle plus p cross. Yeah, so it's the idea that this formula may be used in other cases. In this simple case, yeah, we may omit 2, it will not change the 3. What's the rule? So, the Gini index before split is 20 over 12 over
25.
6.2. 6.2. So, 0.48. Yeah? Okay? And now I decide whether will I split my node into two nodes. I may have different splits. I may split there, here, after 3, or after 4. I have 4 different possible split levels. Yeah. Okay? So let's think how will the Gini index change in the case of which possible split. So we have a possible split A, possible split B, C, and D. Yeah? Okay, we have four possible splits at the first step. Later it will be easy, but for the first split, we have a lot of possibilities. Four is a lot of possibilities. But imagine when a computer grows an actual tree for random forest, it has, let's say, 1,000 variables. Each variable may have, 200s of thousand values, and the computer chooses the best split, so it considers many cases. But we will consider only four cases. So if I split between 1 and 2, yeah, possible split A, my sample will be split into two groups. In the first group, I will have only one observation, 0. Okay. Yeah. In the second group, I will have 1, 1, 0, and 1. Yeah. I will have 3 crosses and 1, 0. Okay. Yeah. I may calculate the Gini index for the left. The Gini index for the left subgroup is equal to 0. Why? Because it's impossible to choose two persons from different classes. Yeah. The Gini index for the right subsample, yeah, is equal to, I may use this simple formula, 2 over 1 over 4 times 3 over 4. Yeah? Uh-huh. And if I have Gini index for the left subsample, I have Gini index for the right subsample, I have Gini index after split. Gini index after the split. It's equal to the proportion of these two groups. One observation here, so I have 1 over 5 times Gini left plus 4 over 5 times Gini right. And I have, this is 0, this is 4 over 5 times 2 times 1 times 3 and 4 times 4 in the denominator. I may get rid of 4. And I have, 3 over 10. Yeah. Am I right? Yeah, 3 over 10. Yeah. So it's one possibility. The Gini index will go down if I use this split. The Gini index will go down from 0.48 to 0.3, okay? So my classification will be better. But there are 3 other possible splits. Yeah? So I consider 3 other possible splits. If I choose, for example, split B, yeah? Split B, in the left node, I have
0.
Zero and one. Yeah, if I use split B, yeah? I have 0 and 1. In the right node, I have
2
crosses and 1 circle. Yeah? Okay? What is the Gini index of the left node?
2, 1 over 0 over 2.
2, 1 over 1 over 2, 1 over 2, 1 over 2, yeah? I use this formula once again. What's the Gini index for the right subclass, subsample?
2 multiplied.
2 multiplied by 1 over 3 times 2 over 3 is equal to 4 over 9, yeah? And the Gini index after this possible split, Gini index after the split. I weight these two Gini indexes. I take 2 over 5 times Gini left plus 3 over 5 times Gini right. Okay? Now I have 2 over 5 times 1 half plus 3 over 5 times 4 over 9. Which split is better? Split B or split A? Which one is better? This one or this one? Which split is better? It's 1 over 5 plus 4 over 15, so it's 7 over 15. Which split is better? This one, 7 over 15, or 0.3?
0.3.
Yeah, this split is better because the lower the Gini index, the clear the classes are separated. Yeah? Yeah?
Yeah, the formula we are using to determine the Gini index.
Sorry?
The formula. Yeah, Vx P0 plus.
Yeah. Two times, not plus. Two times P0 times P.
The correct explanation is that we get is that explanation. That's the formula of the formula. That's it.
Sorry, I don't understand. Explain this formula.
Yeah.
By definition, Gini index, it's a definition, it's a probability of getting two, is this the probability that two randomly chosen objects will be of different classes. If I randomly choose two objects from this set, I have three objects in a set. I randomly choose two objects. First object, and for example, I will pick up one object at random, and you pick up the second object at random. What's the probability that we will choose objects of different classes? Yeah? And there are two sub cases. I may choose cross, and you may choose circle. In this case, we have objects of different classes chosen. And the other possibility is that I have chosen a circle, and you have chosen a cross, yeah? And so we have a formula. So the definition, it's a probability of choosing at random two objects of different classes. And this formula follows this definition, okay? This formula can be applied only in the case of two classes, but the definition of Gini index may be applied in the case of 20 categories. Okay? So the split A is better. We should also consider split C and split D. Let's make a small exercise. Calculate the Gini index after split C. Please calculate. Oh, do I need to show once again? No? So just a small exercise for you. Calculate. Oh yeah, we may make a small split. Yeah. You will calculate the Gini index after the split C, and you will calculate the Gini index after the split D. Yeah. So what if I consider split C? What will be Gini index after the split? And what will be if I consider the split D, what will be the Gini index? Yeah, it's better to use parallel processing in our case.
Ну, делишь между тройкой и четверкой. Кто наверх? 0,1,1, а внизу кто? 0,1.
So, what's the Gini index? So, the formula for Gini index before split is 2 times P circle times P cross. And we need to calculate 2 Gini indexes, and finally we will draw. Yeah, have you calculated? So let's calculate these Gini indexes after split C and after split D, and then we will choose the best. Yeah, I think it's easy to use previous results. For split C, in the left node, I will have
0, 2.
Yeah, 0, 1, and 1.
Mm-hmm.
In the right node, I will have 0, 1. And what's the Gini index?
Divided by 9.
But it's the same. We have already calculated it.
Yeah. Okay.
We have already calculated.
After speed, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the same.
We have already done it. It's exactly left. So in the case of split C, we have 7 over 15. And in the case D, in the left node, we will have what observations?
2, 0, 2.
We have 2 zeros, 2 ones. In the right node, we have 1. So we need to calculate Gini index. For the left node, Gini left is equal to 0.5. Yeah. And for the right node, Gini index is equal to 0. So Gini index after the split will be equal to I weight with the correct weights. Weights are equal to the proportion of observations in each subsample. So 4 over 5 times 0.5 plus 1 over 5 times 0, and the Gini index after the split is equal to
0.4.
So the best split is the split
A.
The first split is the best one. So we have built the beginning just the start, but then it will be faster. So my first question is a split A. So my first question, whether x is greater than 1.5. So first my sample was 1.5. So if the answer is yes, I obtain a subsample 0, like this one. If this the answer is no, I obtain only 0. Yeah? this is the end of tree growing. Yeah, I cannot grow the tree further at this node. Yeah, but I may go further with this node. So how many possible splits do I have? I have three possible splitting. Okay, which one should I choose? Let's call it. It's very quick. Just don't be lazy, and it will be okay because it's very quick way. If I have a subsample, so I have a smaller subset. I have only 1, 1, 0, 1. This is y, x. I have 1. Sorry, no, not 1. 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. In this node, I solve the same problem, but with so first I consider split A, split B, and split C. If I take split A, I will have cross and cross cross 0. If I consider split B, I will have cross cross and cross 0. If I have split C, I have
cross cross 0,
cross cross 0, and cross. Yeah. So I calculate very quickly. Gini left is equal to 0. Here, Gini right is equal to 2 times 2 over 3 times 1 over 3. It's equal to 4 over 9. If Gini index left is equal to 0, Gini right is equal to 1 over 2. And Gini left is equal to 4 over 9, because it's the same. And Gini right is equal to 0. Okay, so I calculate Gini index after the split. Gini index after the split. After Gini after the split. And Gini after the split. So here I have 0, 1 over 2, and I average them, I will have 0.25. Yeah, just the mean. Here I will have 1 over 3 times 0 plus 3 over 4 times what? 4 over 9. And I will have here 1 over 3, so it's 0, 3, 3, 3, 3. And in the for the split C, what value I will obtain of the Gini index after the split? But the same, just look at split A and split C. They give the same classification. Yeah? X, 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 0. So it's 0.33333. So which split should I prefer? A, B, or C?
B.
I prefer the split B. So I ask a question to split at B, X is between 3 and 4. So I ask my question whether X is greater than 3 or 5. If the answer is yes, if the answer is yes, I have 0, 1, and here I have the cross, cross, yeah? So here my tree stops to grow, and it's easy. How should I split here? I have two observations. Let's write them. I have only two observations, y, x, 0, 1, 4, 5. How should I split these observations to obtain perfect prediction? Where should I split my data? Which question should I ask No, no, I ask question about x. Why I predict y using x. I cannot ask question about y. Yeah, between, so we have two observations, 4 and 5, yeah? So my main question is whether x is greater than 4.5, let's say 4.5, and then 4.7 is the same question, yeah? If the answer is yes, we may predict the observation, like, what will be our prediction here?
One,
yeah. And here we predict our, we make prediction that the observation is zero. Okay? Do you understand how to build one tree? Yeah? We have grown one tree.
But why is this 4 and 5? Why just not bigger than 4?
You may ask, it doesn't matter. We might ask a question bigger than 4, bigger than 4.9, doesn't matter, that's the same question. Normally to make the split more robust, we use the mean between two points. So, but you may ask the question whether it's bigger than 4, it's, will, the classification will be exactly the same. If I replace here 3 by 3.2, the classification tree will be the same, okay? Mm-hmm. But to simplify, we always choose the mean between two numbers. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, we have grown only one tree, but how random forest grows many trees? If I repeat this procedure, I will get exactly the same tree, yeah? Mm-hmm. It's, it seems that how to build another tree. How? But I have the same data, I have only one data set. So when we know so how a random forest, how to build, how to grow many trees. So the, now we know how to grow one tree. Okay. So how to grow a forest. How to grow a forest. A random forest, we have nothing random in this algorithm. We have data set, we build a tree. Nothing is random. But the forest is called random forest. It's random forest. So what's random in a random forest? Before growing each tree, we make a random sub sample. Before growing each tree, we make a random subsample of the data set. So, to be how we make a random subsample? More details how to make random subsample. There are many ways to make a random subsample. So, if I have, let's say I have n observations in original data set, and to make a subsample, I choose from these n observations, from these n original observations, I choose randomly n, the same number. Yeah. I choose randomly n observations. Observations with replacement. it's the first source of randomness. So let's illustrate this source of randomness. Suppose I have four people in my data set. I have, Sadiq. It's written
Sadiq,
like this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have Ola. Yeah. Ola. Irina. And me. The sample size is 4, yeah? N is equal to 4. So before classifying each guy as a terrorist or non-terrorist, before growing a tree, I make a random subsample of this data set. For example, I will choose 4 persons with possible replacements. So I choose to build the tree number one. To build a tree number one. I randomly choose 4 persons from this list. I will, for example, I will randomly choose Sadiq 2 times. Yeah, what does it mean with replacement? With replacement, it means that the same person may be chosen twice, or even 3 times. So, for example, Sadiq, Lola, and me. And using these randomly chosen sample, I build a tree. I will have 1 tree. So I repeat the same procedure. To make the forest, I need to grow tree number 2. I repeat this procedure. I randomly sample 4 people with a replacement from this list. Let's say Irina 4 times. It may happen. Irina. I have random subsample with replacement, Irina 4 times. And for this subsample, I grow tree number 2, okay? And this procedure in random forest is repeated normally, at least the more trees you have, the more exact the procedure. So normally 500 trees. Tree number 500. So that's why it's called random forest, because at each step, for each tree, we choose a random subsample of our original data set. We classify them as bad or good guys using their characteristics. And then we have a lot of trees. And so it's the first source of randomness. There is the second source of randomness in the random forest. Second source of randomness. Even with a very powerful computer, it's rather slow to choose the best split. If you have 1,000 variables, and each variable has a lot of values, it's very difficult to check every possible case. It's very time consuming, even on a computer. So the second source of randomness is the following. Before each split, to simplify the brute force search, before each split, m equal to 5. Before each split, some specific number which may be tuned to make the random forest better we may tune this number, but let's say for the moment it's equal to 5. Before each split, 5 explanatory variables are chosen to before search for the best split. At each step, 5 variables are chosen from the list of all variables. And roughly speaking, this is the only number which may be tuned in a random forest. In regression, you may specify this equation or these explanatory variables. In random forest, you take all explanatory variables and you choose one number. There are some default choices, but okay. So when the forest is grown, we have a lot of trees. We have 500 trees. How to make predictions using random forest? So we have random forest. We have a lot of trees. So, random forest, you may imagine that the computer grows a random forest. You have a lot of trees, 500 trees. And to make a forecast, how to make forecast using random forest? You have unknown guy. You don't know whether this guy is good or bad, but you have some metadata about this guy. You know the location of this guy, how often he phones, how often his location is near the, the administration. You know a lot of metadata collected automatically about this guy. You have X, you have Z, you have W. You have a lot of metadata about this guy. But you do not know whether this guy is good or bad. How to make prediction with random forest? So you plug these characteristics into each tree. Okay? You plug these characteristics into each tree. And each tree will give you prediction. For this tree, this guy is a good guy. Oh no, bad guy. For these three, this is good and this is bad. Yeah. So each tree will make, because trees are random, so their predictions may be different. So you plug characteristics of a new object into each tree. Each tree makes one simple forecast. And then you collect all observations and you just have an estimate of a probability that this guy is good or bad. In my case, I have an estimate of probability that this guy is bad. I have only 5 trees, not 500 trees in my case, but I have 5 trees and I have 3 trees which predict that the guy is bad, and 2 trees which predict that the guy is good. Yeah, and so my prediction that this guy is 3/2, that this guy is bad. And we may have some threshold that if this probability is higher than 0.9, we may run the drones to kill him. Yeah? Mm-hmm. But it's our reality. Mm-hmm. It's our reality. Mm-hmm. It works like this.
Nobody has doubts.
Sorry?
Nobody has doubts. It works exactly.
Yeah, it works like this. So
bad guys.
Yeah. So when you receive some advertising in your email about something, maybe it's a result of a random forest which classifies you as a person who needs our super Чудо швабры, I don't know how to say
it.
Yeah, super brooms, yeah.
Wonder mops,
yeah. Yeah. So maybe when you're receiving some spam, it's a result of a random forest algorithm behind it, which classifies you whether you need a super broom or whether you need a super spoon, yeah. So let's make a small break, and then we will do a random forest prediction in R. Okay? Что? Через сколько у нас экзамен? Ну смотри, на следующем занятии мы специально порешаем задачки, чтобы вот по типу на экзамене, и потом тогда будет экзамен.
А можете вот по этой неделе писать какой-то пример экзамена?
Да, конечно, обязательно. Да, в следующий раз мы посвятим ему разбору задач, у нас новых тем не будет, будем только решать. Именно так я и планирую. Ты прикинь от способности. То есть у тебя есть какие-то у тебя должны быть какие-то данные по заемщику. Возраст, я не знаю, там число детей, 16, чего-то прошлых данных по прошлым заемщикам. Да. По прошлым заемщикам. Ты взять их данные. Вернул кредит или не вернул? По прошлым данным, которые есть у банка. Строим случайный лес. А дальше пришел новый, который хочет. Я говорю, у вас какой-то. Мы спрашиваем, какой у тебя возраст? Заполни анкету. Какой у тебя возраст? Сколько там у тебя детей? И вообще женат, не женат? Он нам все сообщает. Мы позвоним в Рэндом Форест. Рэндом Форест дает нам вероятность, что вы вернете.
А это может там
строить лодку,
модели?
Если вопрос, то есть проектная задача, задача прогнозирования, если нам не важно объяснять, но чтобы не прогнозировать, то Рэндом Форест гораздо лучше логика. Логика является простой формой для писателя, что здесь на самом деле побольше. А вот Рэндом Форест, можно с там буквально там больше, более вероятно, что они
предсказать им лучше надо,
Я нарисовал вот такой вид. Там каждая буква там будет 500, и каждая буква на 1000 уровней. Описать это не пойми как. Но хорошо предсказывать. Нужно понять, на чем мы снимаем.
Правильно?
Не совсем. Это немножко разные вещи, они связаны, там одно из другого получается, но это немножко другое. Там есть коэффициент Gini, есть индекс Gini. Они, конечно, вот мы индекс.
Ну, суть такая же. Неравенство
популяции. Ну, они в каком-то смысле меряют тоже неравенство, но это разные вещи. Они один там определяется площадь, рисунки, здесь не совсем то же самое. Хотя названия у них похожи, но оба они имеют в каком-то смысле немножко разные вещи. Они имеют неоднородность, возможности, другой. Неравномерность классификации класса. То есть там просто разные задачи. Здесь мерили, насколько... Ну, ты понимаешь, для этого индекса у нас должно разделить несколько классов, хороших, плохих. А для того индекса там упорядоченность по какому-то количеству примеров, типа богатства, там, за тем индексом, за каждым стоит определенный признак, это богатство. Мы вот откладываем процент всего богатства и...
А, там типа покупки скрытые,
но
здесь...
Наоборот, индекс скрытый,
а там
он не бывает. То есть это немножко разные штуки, хотя называется тоже. Поэтому у вас есть через GSM, нет, то есть обозначать могут по-разному, то есть это все-таки разные. Потому что суть признаков.
Везде стоит
следование
огромных.
А там
богатство
вкладывается.
Да. А еще у вас тут для меня такой
аналитика, ну,
я бы
прятал на
Excel формулу
того,
куда ты после сплита. Мы определили, как средний смешанный джинни слева, джинни справа. У нас есть джинни до сплита, когда они не развиты,
это как спокойной ночи вышли.
Это до сплита. А после сплита джинни индекс клеточки, вот это разделение, считается как вес слева на джинни слева плюс вес справа на джинни справа.
Для нее
ну,
такое.
Потому что... Ну, потому что,
например,
если у меня до сплита, то я сплита, то я на корзинке.
До сплита, на одной и второй. У нас, я так и представляю, что так повезло,
получилось за сплитить их вот так. Джинни слева будет равен нулю, но все одинаковые. Джинни справа будет равен нулю. И понятие джинни после сплита. Ну, будет оправдываться как 1/2 на джинни слева, плюс 1/2 на
джинни справа. Как их подбирать, да, в рекурсии?
Так мы же говорим, вот подбираем вопрос оптимальным образом, чтобы вот, вот так, ну, как подбирать вопрос, ну вот мы сравнивали три вопроса, три сплита, А, Б, С, Д, выбрали Б, самое лучшее. Подбирать.
Перебором?
Да, перебором, но на компьютере. Это же на компьютере делается, потому что ты не руками делаешь, это я просто пояснил один раз, как компьютер сделать. А так на компьютере, то есть это все будет делаться, одна команда он построит лес, вторая команда он предсказывает использовать лес.
Ну ладно, да.
Какие характеристики прикольные? Вес человека, все что угодно. Сколько ты купил шоколада, чтобы...
Я не знаю, как бы, когда
первоначально. Это какие-то характеристики предмета. То есть, если мы решаем проблему выдать или не выдать кредит, то банк может спрашивать у лица, это возраст, пол, есть ли машина, есть ли счет в нашем банке, сумма на счету в нашем банке, не знаю, там, женат, не женат, ну вот любые характеристики объекта, которые мы можем собрать.
Мы все вместе на одном уровне?
Не-не-не, мы выбираем одну наилучшую. То есть выбирается, то есть компьютер перебирает все варианты по этой, или по этой, по этой, по этой, по этой, и выбирает тот сплит, при котором Gini падает сильнее всего. И он и дальше разбивает. Мы дальше строим дерево, пока не дойдем до идеального прогноза. А потом таких деревьев подсушивают, потом отрывают. Что? Ну, сейчас сделаем. Ну, конечно, на компьютере это легко. Одна команда. Там понять тяжело, что делает компьютер. А, ну, как набрал, сделал. Ты же не видишь 500 деревьев, в памяти их храни.
Понять, как это делается.
Смотришь, там один компьютер.